requested with the manager's budget is $69,000.
I would like to add, too, that we are using the plow and wing that came with the truck. And we're trading in one of our older wings that came off one of our trucks in the '60s that we've been reusing, that we've welded and patched a number of times. So as far as the plow and the wing, those are going to be staying, and we're going to be reusing them.
So we can reduce $13,500?
No.
No? As is, a $69,000 allotment.
Well, that's the frame. The frames, at one point, we were transferring frames and hydraulics from the truck to the next, but we had bad luck with that. We're finding that salt and corrosion has really raised havoc with the equipment. By the end of the life of the second truck that it's gone to, hydraulic is 30 years old, put it amongst them.
Phyllis, what are the spray systems?
The spray systems are auxiliary tanks that are mounted on our sanding units that are loaded with liquid calcium, and it applies the calcium to the salt as it comes off the hopper channel. Right now, we have a spray bar at the transfer station that sprays the entire load. And unfortunately, it's overspray, sprays the cap of the truck, and it eats the truck. The liquid calcium is very corrosive. And this way here, we can load the trucks up at night, and we can make the choice whether to apply calcium or not. Whereas now, if we load the trucks up, we can't spray the whole load effectively if we want to use liquid calcium. So it gives us the option, really. It's more convenience, and I think in the long run, it's better for vehicle maintenance.
And so depending on the condition of the road.
Some of Greater Portland's most beautiful sights aren't exactly what you'd call beautiful, but when you know what to do with trash, beautiful things happen. At Regional Waste Systems, we do beautiful things to trash every day. We generate electricity, recycle, reuse, everything we can to be sure we keep the piles and piles of this stuff from ending up in the landfills. We don't do it to make money, we do it for you. To help you keep your communities clean in the least expensive way possible. And we're always looking for new ways to handle all our trash. How did all this get started? Well, in 1974, Portland, South Portland, Scarborough, and Cape Elizabeth were faced with the important question.
Hey, what are we gonna do with all this trash?
The answer came when the leaders of those four communities put their heads together to figure out what they could do with all their ugly trash. So they formed Regional Waste Systems to deal with all that trash. The people of Portland, South Portland, Scarborough, and Cape Elizabeth shared ownership of RWS. They soon found out just how right the time was for Regional Waste Systems, because in 4 short years, RWS was handling more than 263,000 pounds of trash each day.
Sure sounds like tons of trash.
Certainly is. And today that number is up to around 959,000 pounds a day, which is 175,000 tons a year. That's enough trash to cover Maine from Elliott to Augusta. And it's not just the four original owners anymore. Right now, 20 towns share ownership of RWS. And sharing ownership helps the towns keep their taxes down. 11 other towns, called associate members, use our services too. But if it were your job, where would you put all this trash?
Here?
Nope, wouldn't fit. We're running out of room.
Here?
Oh, of course not. That's just not right.
Here?
That's a start. After the towns collect the trash, it comes to this plant on Blueberry Road on the outskirts of Portland. The materials that can be recycled go to companies that turn them into useful things. Newspapers are made into things like berry baskets. Plastics get turned into detergent bottles and toys. Glass gets crushed and comes back as bottles and jars. Cans are crushed and can even be used to make auto parts. Leaves are composted and can be used to fertilize the gardens in our parks. What's left over is dumped into a huge pile.
So do you just let that pile of stuff rot?
No, sir. We burn the trash in a special furnace that turns the heat into electricity. And there isn't a more efficient plant in the country. And each year, the trash we burn produces millions of kilowatts of power. That's enough electricity for nearly 15,000 homes. The trash we burn lights lights, cooks meals, and heats homes. Beautiful.
All that burning must do something awful to the air.
It doesn't. You see, we scrub the fumes clean before they go out our stack, so that what comes out here is healthier than what's coming off this barbecue.
Let me get this straight. The trash comes in, gets burned in a furnace, and turned into electricity.
Exactly. And when it comes to protecting the environment, our plant meets or beats all government rules and regulations. In other words, it's clean as can be. Oh, and don't worry about the ashes from all that trash. It's clean too. These fish know it. They're swimming in water taken from our ash disposal site in Scarborough.
I get it. What you guys do to trash is beautiful.
That's right. But we wish people would think more about reducing, reusing, and recycling. Think about composting and find ways to make less trash.
I'll tell all my friends to do that stuff.
Great. And we'll keep looking for even better ways to do beautiful things to trash.
It certainly is obvious that regional waste systems is a valuable and essential part of our communities. In the truest sense of the word, you and I, we, the member communities, are owners of RWS. And from the very beginning, we have worked together to seek out the most effective, technologically advanced methods of solid waste disposal. In these times when societies and governments are so fragmented within themselves in their approach to issues, we have become a model of how people and governments can work successfully together. The member communities have assumed a cooperative and coordinated responsibility, financially and environmentally, for RWS. The Board of Directors is the important link between our communities and RWS. The Board makes decisions regarding budget and policy on behalf of the communities we represent. We work to establish the tipping fees, which are reassessed annually. Each member community pays the same amount per ton. And those communities that are associate members pay a 20% surcharge per ton. Emissions from the plant fall well below all federal and state regulations and guidelines. And the trash that's burned produces enough electricity to satisfy 20% of the residential demand in all 20 member communities. I am really very proud. I'm happy to be part of this organization. I have tremendous respect for the staff and for the other members of the board. I know it may be difficult to believe that a group of people can get so involved and animated when they talk trash, but we do, because with all of you, we are determined to preserve our environment.
Well, in 1974, Portland, South Portland, Scarborough, and Cape Elizabeth were faced with the important question.
Hey, what are we going to do with all this trash?
The answer came when the leaders of those four communities put their heads together to figure out what they could do with all their ugly trash. So they formed regional waste systems to deal with all that trash. The people of Portland, South Portland, Scarborough, and Cape Elizabeth shared ownership of RWS. They soon found out just how right the time was for regional waste systems, because in 4 short years, RWS was handling more than 263,000 pounds of trash each day.
Sure sounds like tons of trash.
Certainly is. And today that number is up to around 959,000 pounds a day, which is 175,000 tons a year. That's enough trash to cover Maine from Elliott to Augusta. And it's not just the four original owners anymore. Right now, 20 towns share ownership of RWS. And sharing ownership helps the towns keep their taxes down. 11 other towns, called associate members, use our services too. But if it were your job, where would you put all this trash?
Here?
Nope, wouldn't fit. We're running out of room.
Here?
Oh, of course not. That's just not right.
Here?
That's a start. After the towns collect the trash, it comes to this plant on Blueberry Road on the outskirts of Portland. The materials that can be recycled go to companies that turn them into useful things. Newspapers are made into things like berry baskets. Plastics get turned into detergent bottles and toys. Glass gets crushed and comes back as bottles and jars. Cans are crushed and can even be used to make auto parts. Leaves are composted and can be used to fertilize the gardens in our parks. What's left over is dumped into a huge pile.
So do you just let that pile of stuff rot?
No, sir. We burn the trash in a special furnace that turns the heat into electricity. And there isn't a more efficient plant in the country. And each year, the trash we burn produces millions of kilowatts of power. That's enough electricity for nearly 15,000 homes. The trash we burn lights lights, cooks meals, and heats homes. Beautiful.
All that burning must do something awful to the air.
It doesn't. You see, we scrub the fumes clean before they go out our stack, so that what comes out here is healthier than what's coming off this barbecue.
Let me get this straight. The trash comes in, gets burned in a furnace, and turned into electricity.
Exactly. And when it comes to protecting the environment, our plant meets or beats all government rules and regulations. In other words, it's clean as can be. Oh, and don't worry about the ashes from all that trash. It's clean too. These fish know it. They're swimming in water taken from our ash disposal site in Scarborough.
I get it. What you guys do to trash is beautiful.
That's right. But we wish people would think more about reducing, reusing, and recycling. Think about composting and find ways to make less trash.
I'll tell all my friends to do that stuff.
Great. And we'll keep looking for even better ways to do beautiful things to trash.
It certainly is obvious that regional waste systems is a valuable and essential part of our communities. In the truest sense of the word, you and I, we, the member communities, are owners of RWS. And from the very beginning, we have worked together to seek out the most effective, technologically advanced methods of solid waste disposal. In these times when societies and governments are so fragmented within themselves in their approach to issues, we have become a model of how people and governments can work successfully together. The member communities have assumed a cooperative and coordinated responsibility, financially and environmentally, for RWS. The board of directors is the important link between our communities and RWS. The board makes decisions regarding budget and policy on behalf of the communities we represent. We work to establish the tipping fees, which are reassessed annually. Each member community pays the same amount per ton. And those communities that are associate members pay a 20% surcharge per ton. Emissions from the plant fall well below all federal and state regulations and guidelines. And the trash that's burned produces enough electricity to satisfy 20% of the residential demand in all 20 member communities. I am really very proud. I'm happy to be part of this organization. I have tremendous respect for the staff and for the other members of the board. I know it may be difficult to believe that a group of people can get so involved and animated when they talk trash, but we do. because with all of you, we are determined to preserve our environment.
Equipment maintenance, 7,000, contingency, 600. Alarms, 500. Supplies, 2,000, and no request for capital outlay.
Should be 310 for uniform.
It is.
310
yep.
For uniform, I'm sorry, I just stated that one.
Well, the big ticket item obviously is regional waste systems, Bob. We had a presentation by their leadership this week. Is there any possibility that any of these numbers could be adjusted substantially from the time that you submitted this budget?
Not that I can see. I did draw the estimated tonnage figure. Last year we estimated 3,700 tons, and due in part to the economy, we're seeing less demolition, roofing jobs, construction jobs, and some of that material would go into the compactor and then be reflected as tonnage. That has decreased, and recycling obviously has had a big part, of that reduction. So those two things in fold are showing that as a decrease.
And do you feel that in particular the recycling cost to haul the material versus putting it in the compactor, we're still ahead of the game?
Oh, I think so, definitely. You've got some avoided costs there, and the recycling efforts are working a lot more than I anticipated. The public is very good about separating things, and as you can see our reports, we're number one for residential communities in recycled tonnage, so I think the citizen doing a bang-up job, and hopefully it will continue. But we are saving some money, there's no question about it.
But you think that's going to be a fairly solid figure, even if we get a second recycling bin over at the Pond Cove shopping area?
Oh, I think so. I mean, I think if you get the second container, you're going to be doing more recycled tonnage. But I think that's very realistic, I believe.
I think the recycling points out the success of the council's policy towards that, and the good work our recycling committee has done in conjunction with Public Works. Nice to see it pay off some. Bill?
That five hauls a week for $20 a haul. Are you doing five hauls a week now, or is that something you anticipate the other container?
What I've anticipated is that we'd probably haul the other container less than we're hauling right now, and hauling this one a couple of more times to offset that. So we're looking at probably one or two more additional hauls than we're doing right now.
So
and that could fluctuate too.
You're doing five right now?
I think we're doing four.
Four. No, I just wondered if that's why you figured five hauls, because I usually see the truck when it goes down by my house rattling and banging.
Anything else on refuse? Okay, moving on please to sewer. Budget item 815. We're starting on page 223.
I'll briefly go over the revenues on sewer, which show up. It's tough to see, but it's on page 223. As you can see, you do have the impact there of the rate increase that was adopted earlier this year. The budget is fully balanced with a projected surplus of $2,200. The total sewer fund budget is $1,360,000.
Okay. and I believe it's, the council is all aware that we are considering looking at doing a revisit to, I would call it, the policies and the sewer ordinance to some extent, and not that it's going to have any impact on this budget, but it's something tied in with sewers that is one of the council goals to look at the situation. Any general council questions on the sewer?
Yeah, the only problem I have, I got 223. I was looking at the gift card, so I didn't get to the right page.
Are you with us now, sir?
I'm with you now.
All right, terrific. Now we're on 225. We have full-time payroll, $12,246. Overtime payroll, $672. Uniform rental, $310. Sewer line maintenance, $10,000. Contingency, $200. Portland Water District assessment, $948,000. Administrative costs, $6,000. Allowance for uncollectibles, $1,800. Gasoline, $200. No capital outlay request. Debt service, $376,527. Any comments?
I have one comment to the manager. You feel that we might hear something before this budget goes together as far as the Portland Water District?
We will, but it won't affect the sewer assessment.
It won't affect that?
Just the water rate side.
And what, you use less water, which, or you don't have a meter in it?
You're talking about the Water District assessment?
Yeah.
No, that's the fee that we pay to the city of South Portland. It's the operation of the treatment plant, electricity and everything else here. It's the debt service that the district assumed when the plant went into place. It's the sludge disposal cost. You know, the water that they use in that plant over there is probably 1/100 of 1% of the whole sewer fund budget. It's a very, very small amount.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Is that all that you're with us for? This is just after the second green tab, page 229. Cemetery.
You can see you have the revenues here as well. This does show, again, a projected surplus. However, you know, there's a real change here, and that's investment income is down quite a bit by over 20%. Something we hope to work on to look at investing Riverside on a much longer term basis. Right now we've been investing short term. We've got to change that policy for the best interest of the cemetery.
Any general questions on the cemetery?
No, they're all good people.
On page 231, excuse me. So those are the revenues. We're projecting $13,000 in dividends and $2,200 in burials and markers. For expenditures, part-time payroll, $6,360, overtime, $370, consulting services, $500. That's right. Person who allocates the lots.
He sells the lots. I don't know what allocates rather than reading your life. Oh, is this the amount of public works?
Take the money for
it. Suppose she allocates them, yeah.
Well,
in a way she does. Huh?
She sells them.
Okay.
And she also, she very, very helpful. And,
does an excellent job of that.
Debbie, she works very closely with Debbie on a number of issues as well.
Okay. Miscellaneous supplies, $1,000. General fund payment, $3,000. Burials, $2,500. Markers, $700. No capital outlay request. Are there any concerns? Okay. Very good. Mr. Malley, thank you.
Any questions at all?
We may be talking to you again about the truck situation.
Next year, we'll remember to invite you for lunch, too.
Hurt my feelings again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good.
I know, we were discussing it earlier.
Do you want to keep saying?
Yeah, why don't we?
We're going to start on what was listed as your afternoon schedule. We're already half hour behind. Start with account one, the 110 account, the administration.
I think we'll go right in the order of all the 100 accounts, because I think we can get through them fairly quick. 100 includes all of the full-time payroll, all at the same pay level as the prior year. Part-time payroll, no amount provided, telephone, $6,000. Printing and advertising, that again includes the town report, some of the this year's cost, which was $1,772. Also includes photocopy costs, some other things. Postage is an area with increasing costs because of postal rate increases, as well as with sending out a lot more mail on tax due notices and liens. How many tax bills do we have now, Jerry? Tax accounts?
Approximately 4,000.
Yeah, so just to mail out the tax bills a year, you know, that is 8,000 pieces of mail at you know, almost 30 cents a piece. It's not quite that. So you can see just, you know, it doesn't take much to get up to $10,000 in postage. The other major expense there, whenever we send out a pass due, a lien notice, it comes out of that account, and those are quite a bit of money for the certified mail. The travel account is mileage reimbursement. That's $2,300. That includes $1,000 for all the mileage that I do in Greater Portland, as well as it also includes the mileage for all the other personnel.
Phyllis?
I just had a question on this one. Is this mileage for other personnel and mileage outside Greater Portland for the manager?
Yeah. Yeah, the agreement with the council is that you pay for all the mileage for me out of the 1,000 in Cape Elizabeth, Portland, South Portland, Scarborough, I think Thelma. But if I went to Augusta or something like that, that isn't included in that. However, most of my trips to Augusta are reimbursed by...
By your other responsibility.
Yeah. But okay. if I go to Bangor for a meeting, like the managers had an interchange up there in January, the town paid my mileage.
Okay.
Dues and memberships, $850. Conferences and meetings, $2,250. This, I believe, you know, is the only out of town in any of the out of state in the administrative area, or in any of the departmental budgets. And that's for the New England clerks. Something Debbie is an officer of. And, you know, meeting. Were you meeting this year, Deb?
Sturbridge,
Massachusetts. Professional services. I think there is an important addition here, and that's negotiation assistance, $5,000. That is, you know, I think we need to do a lot of work on entirely new language in our contracts, as well as in, you know, changing over to what we were discussing earlier, the cafeteria plan. I think we're looking at a whole lot of new issues, and I think it would be helpful to have someone with a strong labor background to assist with that. Office equipment, $7,500. Office supplies, $7,000. Outlay, $7,000. The personal computer and software, that is to replace Barbara Ray's computer. Her word processing system dates back before the invention of PCs. It is the worst word processing system that one could ever see or experience. Deb is, I think, dealing with it as well. But it is really tough. It's the software is about 11, 12 years old now. I think, you know, the IBM PC only came out 10 years ago. So. We really want to replace that, and the problem is she loses things. And, what I'd like to do is have a system so that if I work on mine, we could copy the disk, and I could take it out to her so she could work on it some more. Records preservation is about what it describes. That's $2,000. That is for, particularly, Debbie and I still want to discuss this some more. There's some of the old records, but I'm very concerned as well, particularly with the financial records since we've become computerized. They really need to be bound and preserved, and right now it's, you know, it's like, you know, the sheets that you have there, most of that just in these cheap plastic folders tucked in a drawer somewhere, and we need to find a way to better preserve those and make sure that they're here when, so that we're honoring the State Records Preservation Board guidelines. The main printer replacement is the printer up here. That has been out of commission 9 out of the last 12 days, probably. What I'd really like to do is cut this from the budget and buy it immediately. This is the printer that we use for running the cash receipts all the time. It's the one we use for a lot of the major reports. And, you know, for example, the sheet you have before you, I tried to run a week ago, and every time I go, the printer was broken and the serviceman was on his way again. So what I'd like you to do is to cut that out of the budget with the understanding that I'll find the funds to buy it this year.
Does anybody have a problem with that?
No problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Let's see that. So there's a $3,000 cut right there. Phyllis?
Does the school department use our printer?
They have additional printers upstairs.
They do, so it's basically just the town offices.
Yeah.
And the maintenance agreement also is just for our own computer. The computer maintenance is just for our computers, nothing to do with the schools.
We get a bill, and when the bill comes in, we code it by how much is ours.
So that's shared. Okay.
But some of what we subsidize is for the printers upstairs because that's where the bills are paid.
Okay.
Dee and I sit down and discuss it every year. When the bill comes in, not before.
Are there any other concerns in administration accounts? All right, thank you. Assessing and codes, Mr. Daver. This is on page 49 of your book.
Great. Good afternoon. Guess we're all set to begin?
Yes, sir, we
okay.
Are.
Account code is 120. I begin with 1001, which is full-time payroll. There is no increase in the payroll, and you're looking at 90,400. Part-time payroll, that was deleted. A correction was made in December of 91, and we are not asking for any part-time payroll. That's zeroed out. Printing and advertising, the breakdown indicates that we use this for our annual assessing forms, the purchase of or production of maps, and also for the assessor's legal ad, which I've stopped running in the normal sense and with the Portland Press Herald because of costs. So we try to do it in the Cape Courier or some other method, which is cheaper. That's 500, which is not an increase over last year. The travel is really the cost for the assessor and the code enforcement officer to use the vehicles for town business. This is not changed from last year, and that's $4,000 divided by 2,000 apiece. Again, that request is the same as it was last year. Dues and membership, there was a decrease in this particular account in membership only because one was dropped, which became expensive and no longer deemed necessary. There is a saving there, it dropped from 570 to 345 a year. What this includes is we do have to belong to the Boca Building Code, that's an annual requirement.
Just a minute, Jerry. It still shows in the books as 570. It shows in the printout as 345 for anybody.
Okay.
Thank you.
And the various association memberships are listed in the breakdown. If there's any questions on the
The one cutout was the National Association of Review Appraisers.
Yes.
NARA.
NARA. They're headquartered in Arizona, by the way. Not that it has anything to do with the budget. Nor has it got anything to do with the next item, which is conferences and meetings and slash training. As you can see, there is a conference in St. Louis, Missouri, and the assessor, if he does go, will go paying his own way. So there is no, nothing, there is no sum in the budget to pay for outside conference at all, as you can see. There is in the budget, though, some funds so that some training can take place. It's been reduced. You're looking at a total of 1,300. The reason that I felt the training should stay in the budget, even though we are in tough straits, is that we're required by state, talking about the Code Enforcement Office, required by state to have so many hours to maintain certifications, which is required by the state under law. Also, for assessing, the assessor has to put in 16 hours a year, in-state, out-of-state, for assessing type training. And these are also mandated by the state just to maintain our certifications. And also, I've allowed for the secretary, which if she so chooses to, although she is not required to be certified, can take some training in computer etiquette or anything that would fall into that line. Any questions?
Sanders is a real whiz on the computer. Always, to give an example, this week I signed 160-something letters that she had prepared, sending out new addresses to a lot of the roads in Cape Elizabeth that had never had street numbers. And she got them all out on the system, individually addressed. It's those types of things that are very helpful and indicative of a lot of the things that are going on that people generally never hear about.
Well, that brings up the computers that we have, although we've been lucky, as I indicated in last year's budget, to get some of the hardware that we've gotten to in the office. We're able now to renumber houses. We're doing People's Cove and McKinney Point and places like that that doesn't have street addresses. Which one?
Dave Colley.
Dave Colley. Places that just never thought they'd ever have a house name do now or will be. Office equipment is same as last year. I'm sorry, I missed professional offices 2010. Professional services, excuse me. This account has been reduced, has been increased. The membership was decreased, and what happened is the appraisal licensing is $250 a year. I felt strongly about the fact that I probably should be thinking of being a licensed appraiser in this state, as opposed to belonging to some organization in Arizona. And this goes along with the requirement that appraisers in the state of Maine be licensed, those involving federal funds. This account involves tax map maintenance for $1,000, the upgrading of maps. This will be important this year because the wetlands will have to be put onto the tax maps. Deeds, which we buy from the county, pricing guides. We're not buying any Polaroid film, and we're discontinuing using a Marshall Swift computer hookup with California. It was useful in 1987, 88, 89, but no longer useful. And the license, the appraisal license, is $250 a year, and that will come up to $2,725, as opposed to $2,600. That's where that membership was dropped and this one was picked up.
Okay, thank you.
Office equipment, we are requesting the same as last year, which is, we reduced that one. Because of the purchase in office supplies, we're going to be buying less and trying to run it longer, that kind of thing.
Yeah, he's also got some money in the revalve program for,
yes,
you know, to pick up some stuff.
That's true. The last, and probably the, I hate to say the most important, because I, full-time payroll is pretty important, but this is also
the important project.
Right. This is an important project. It's the On the capital outlay, we are asking for a revaluation program. We're requesting a $40,000 increase to do that, complete that program. For a total budget request this year of $139,770. That does not include any of the items that you would have under such things as workman comp, main state retirement, and the like. So a pure budget item is $139,770.
I'm sorry, my numbers are way off here.
Yeah.
On the computerized printout.
They're correct.
No, that's where they're correct.
Those are correct.
These are correct on the printout?
Yeah.
On all these past accounts?
Yeah.
That nothing is matching at all?
I think there were a couple that didn't match.
There were a couple that were changed.
They could put in the computer, but
they're in the computer correctly. It was the $345 for dues and membership, and the $2725 for professional services. We're not that way in the budget notebook, but they are in the printout for this morning. And the $139 figure Jerry's giving you did not include the benefit numbers that we now say are included in your budget.
And then, you know, next year when the budgets come in, they will be in the individual departments with the running sheets.
Phyllis?
Jerry, when you first made your presentation on starting the reevaluation, you said that this would be a pretty straightforward number, because in the past you've already purchased some of the cards and everything else that you need for previous years.
Yes, we've been planning for a couple of years.
So these other miscellaneous office supplies and everything that you're going to be needing is in addition to what you've already purchased.
Right. We're talking here basically the cost of paper. Because we're computerized, we're generating an awful lot of paper. And in 1987, we produced I can't tell you how many sheets of paper the computer ran, but they were all preliminary sheets. And after we run these preliminary numbers, then we have to run through the final sheets. We do use an awful lot of paper. I'm not sure we'd probably use the whole $2,000 for paper, but when you're talking about paper, you're also talking about you're talking about ribbon, you're talking about other things to hold the paper and files and those kinds of things.
So the overall cost of the reevaluation really is going to be more than $40,000.
I don't anticipate that to be.
If you figure in what you purchased in the past.
If you, okay, yes, I'm sorry. If you go back and say the cards cost $700 or $800, and if you go back and say we've upgraded the software, I think the only thing that we have purchased were the cards out of last year's budget.
I think it's all heard just now.
Yes. I have the revaluation breakdown, which I'm sure you have. It's the outlay 4001. I'm not sure what page you're on.
52.
And revaluation cost breakdown is this way. The field inspections is we break down to $28,300. That would be hiring someone for 52 weeks, or hiring someone for 6 months, Depending on how we perceive the program starting date. If we began exactly on July 1st, 92, we'd run it for 12 months. If we began January 1st of next year, then of course it would be 6 months. It might be 6 months into the next budget. I'm not sure that the whole $40,000 will be spent in this budget. I would like to think we could start July 1st of 92 and then complete the program in time for use in 94.
My preference is that if we're going to undertake a revaluation program, that we fund it, and that, you know, would we not come back later on for additional funds. I think the need is there at this point from I think some of the previous reports Jerry's given you, and I very much wanted you to know up front what the cost is. And I think another thing very commendable is, you know, we had originally talked about this being a $50,000 project. And I think by concentrating the time more and, you know, looking for the maximum efficiencies and utilizing Jerry out as well, doing some of the more complicated properties along with the person who would come in and do field inspections, I think we can do it for about $10,000 less than the original budget of $50,000. But I think it's important that we go at it, we keep at it, and make it a major initiative of the office for the entire fiscal year. Take advantage of the good weather this coming summer.
The 1979 revaluation was the last time we had an outside firm come in. They did everything for us. It cost $44,000 at that time. The 87 program, which was really less field work but more computerization of all our records, thinking ahead, ran us around 30 or less. This particular project for 40, or a little more than 40, includes all field work and utilizing the computerized data we have now. Our software with Cato, with Northern Data, is such that it can be upgraded at very little cost. In fact, I think I indicated here that it would be, $1,500. I've been told it might run under $1,000. So the software enhancements are not going to be expensive only because we've had them in the program for 2-3 years.
The important thing here is for the first time since 79, we're actually going to be out doing a lot of home inspections. That was not done last time. Right. Property inspections, not just homes.
We're also having the cost of resketching the cards. I have not found that the scanning with a computer is adequate, although there is some hardware out there where you can scan the sketches onto cards, but I don't think it's working. At least we can't afford to get the machine that would work the way we want it to work, is what I'm saying. So we will pay someone to resketch the cards. Computer data entry means we would pay someone extra to key punch rather than tie up Sandra on a daily basis, who answers the phone and does all of our other work, including permits for the building inspector. Here we would request some temporary office assistance, but this would be merely to make sure that towards the end of the program that all of this paper that we are producing ends up in the correct folder and goes up in a notice form that's, that matches the assessment. Pretty much it. I answer any questions you may have.
Jane?
Could we draw on existing personnel?
Well,
to help with that end of the evaluation period.
You mean as far as the office assistance? Mm-hmm. It's a possibility. I don't feel it's a high priority item, but it is a detail that needs to be addressed when you're trying to shuffle an awful lot of paper in a short amount of time.
I think, Jane, this $1,000 in that line item contemplates that Sandra will do, along with Jerry, 85% to 90% of the clerical end of the revaluation. It's already assumed that, you know, otherwise you'd need a full-time secretary for the revaluation. The field inspections, it is contemplated that Jerry will do an awful lot of them and be out there, which then, you know, we look at the, we are seeing building issues coming up again. If you look at your revenues, people are building again, and he's got to be out there, you know, doing the regular inspections as well as, when you do something like this, you know, the phone rings constantly. People are very concerned about the values of their properties, this, whatever the town considers them. We only have to look at neighboring communities and see that. You can't help but have everyone else in the office pitching.
I'm talking about other areas of the front office.
It would help a little bit, but for the most part, you know, during off times, but for the most part, you know, you can't really depend on them because, you know, people come in, you never know when they're going to come in, and, you know, people can be in line for, there's people that come in and up to that counter, they're there 45 minutes to an hour sometimes. You know, people come in and they do their dogs, they do their boats, they do their trailers, they do their snowmobiles, they do their cars, they pay their taxes. They pay off their liens. You know, and people can, they're with in, you know, particularly with a new car. People, I've seen people at that counter for 2 hours conducting their business and not complaining.
I've had a number of citizens talk to me about this issue, about the contemplation of doing a reval. All of them have been in favor of it. They're concerned that we get into a situation similar to what we've seen, say, in Portland. It goes too long. Situations have changed. You did a very thorough presentation to us last fall, I believe it was, about the need for a reval. This gets us back to a policy decision at the council level. if we are supportive of a revaluation, and then if we are supportive of funding it in the 93 fiscal year.
Where are we at now? 70, 80%?
No, as a matter of fact, as we speak, the percentages, we're at 91%.
91?
Yes. I think as I spoke to you the last time, we're at 89, or very close to it. The quality rating is what we're judged by as far as assessing, is around 14, or 14.13. 10 or under is excellent. In 1987, we had a quality rating of 8.3, I believe. Very, very good. Anything under 10 is excellent, under state guidelines. 15 is fair, and 20 is poor. So when you start to push into 15, what that means is the uniformity of assessments is starting to fail. It's not a case of the values, it's a case of uniformity. So what we've got is some of our ranches are not comparing very well to other ranches, and we need to get back out there and recheck those ranches. Some have depreciated more, some have appreciated. So right now, on the state guidelines, if you're above 70% of market, 70% of market, right, if our ratio is above 70%, which we are, and if we're below 20, which we are, we're in good with the state. But I think the bigger problem is as we let it go on, the repair of something like this becomes, let's say, more difficult, more objectionable, less palatable, all of those things. And I think the taxpayers understand that the reason we would do a revaluation now in these times would be not because we need additional tax revenues, not that we want to go into any particular neighborhood to raise values. I think more or less to spread out the fairness of it all so that everybody pays their fair share.
So you could call it equalization?
Yes, I called it that in 1987. And then I got away from it. You know, the term now is it's out again. Revaluation is an acceptable term to use. Oh. And, I'm using that.
Sorry, I'm outdated. So if you're 91 now and we did it, we'd never be 100%, would we? Be 98, 99? Would it be 100%?
If I did a revaluation today,
yeah,
we would try to get it very close to 100%, though. If we did that, the rate would have to drop accordingly, provided everything remains the same. We're not that far from 100. I think you've got a good point. There are going to be some properties that would go down in value if we did a revaluation today. We have to recognize that the market is a little sluggish in condominiums, for instance. Although we tried to keep up with those, in a revaluation, they would be decreased. Certain other neighborhoods where the values may have been retained on a high level because of 87, where the market was different. So we'd have to go back out there and rethink our values in all the neighborhoods.
Well, the way the market is today, what have you, I think you'll find it. People think what they get. Figure what they get into their house and they want to sell, they're going to reduce the price in order to move it. That's so that would affect the valuation when you went out and evaluated it, right?
That is a fair statement, yes. But by the same token, there are still some people, Bill, that are getting the value on the property that they're trying to get in the marketplace. There are some properties that are moving, but there are some that are not. We've got to make sure is that we recognize the fact that some neighborhoods may have more slow movers than fast movers, and we need to go out there and revamp the appraisal.
Somebody mentioned about the building again.
I just said that.
Do you know right off the top of your head how many new homes started in the last year, 6 months?
A year would be, I believe we're doing 25 units, if not 27.
Is that right?
A building permit income just for single family homes this year so far is $8,885. Ernie mentioned to me yesterday there were potential for a sizable new home. You know, that it was just one home, but it was very, very sizable. So, and, you know, you look around town, you go over to Ted Wainwright's development,
It's a hotel.
Here and there, you know, what's going up is still, it's a mess going up.
It's not cheapies.
No.
Let's get a feel for the support for this item, $40,000 in outlay to start the revale program, to do the revale program. Phyllis?
I think it's something that is necessary, particularly actual field inspection of properties to try to equalize the value throughout the town.
Wayne?
Yes.
Carl?
I'm leaning that direction.
A yes direction?
Yes.
Your dad's a yes. Herb?
Yeah.
Jane?
Mm-hmm.
Phil?
Yep.
Yes.
I got my work.
She's napping now, we'll see.
I thought the summer's gonna be slow, but I'm ready.
Yeah, I'm delighted we could come to that decision. I wholeheartedly support that. I know it's gonna serve the town well.
Jerry's very courageous to do this because assessors are the most unpopular people in town when these things get a little.
He's been doing it.
He's five too.
He's run the main towns with my, all my cohorts wrote an article that said it's, takes a lot of guts to have a revaluation, but we don't have a town like the one he's in, so it's a different situation.
We will expect cooperation.
Still there to get my best.
Great. Thank you very much, Jerry. Thank you for your budget prep and being here today. Planning, please, Marie? For the 125 accounts planning, we have Maureen O'Meara, our town planner, with us.
Hi. I'll just start in.
I think that's gonna be fine for the department. We can, and this is on page 59 of our budget book.
Tell the chef our page.
Yeah, no.
Just on that first account, the amount, is the amount on the computer sheet? Was a questioning of that.
Full-time, $36,382, there's a step.
No, it's the amount that's, no, it's the amount, there was a step last year.
There was a step, okay.
It's the amount that's listed, you know, in the detail below there for.
Right.
$699.66 times 52.
Thank you.
Okay. So there was a step last year, but there was another one. And that's for the full-time planner. Just moving down to line 2004, printing and advertising. That originally last year was 900. In the mid-year reductions, it was reduced to 700. That item really is somewhat dependent on the activity at the planning board level. If there are a lot of projects coming forward, then they have to be advertised for public hearing, and that money gets used up. I also expect that some of that money is going to be used for printing of a report for the Town Center Planning Committee. But most of these have been just carryovers from the previous year. Under travel, $100, approximately 350 miles. That's a cost that I bill the town when I travel out of town. Any travel I do in town, I do not file any requests for reimbursement. Under 2007, dues and memberships, there is an increase in that line item. Last year, there was a membership in the American Planning Association and the Northern New England chapter of the American Planning Association, and actually that paid for itself last year with the session I think most of you attended at the Sonesta. So that is of the memberships, and I'm involved in that one, I think is the most beneficial. There's also a publication, a planning magazine that comes in every month as part of that, and I've been able to use at least two of those articles directly, sending them to the planning board on the road classification work that they're doing right now. Maine Association of Planners, that's the statewide organization, and that helps me stay in touch with what's going on at the state level. The new one is the American Institute of Certified Planners. This is the only planner certification program that I'm aware of. The $240 would be to pay for the testing and for a one-year membership in AICP. I anticipate that if I were to take the test, I would also enroll in the prep course, which I do at my own expense. But that is the new cost in there. I assume you'll stop me if you have any questions?
Yes.
Okay. Going on to the next one, 2009, conferences and meetings. The budget that's anticipated there is for approximately one meeting, a workshop for each member of the planning board at approximately $35, and this goes along with their efforts to try to educate themselves and stay abreast of new information. There's also some money in there for training meetings for myself and for the annual state conference. I didn't attend the annual state conference this year. The program didn't really apply to the issues in Cape Elizabeth, so that really is something that I'll look at when it comes up next year. I also anticipate that if board members don't see or find out about any workshops that they're interested in, and town center planning committee members hear about workshops that they would be interested in, I might use some of that money for them instead. And again, I would like to point out with that NACAPA conference session that happened last fall, that all members of the town center planning committee were invited and were not required to pay for that session. If they had attended the whole conference, they would have to pay for that. Going to the next one, 2010 professional services. This is the second largest line item in this budget. Right now, it pays for engineering services. These, again, are very dependent upon how much activity there is at the planning board level. So far this year, there seem to be more projects coming in than there were last year. So this is kind of a tenuous number. It depends on how much time the engineer has to spend on reviewing projects. I've also added in there the cost for subdivision inspections. It seems to be taken out of this line item in the past, so we might as well just list it because that's what's happening. The other thing I've done is taken out some money and identified it as mapping funds. It appears that every year there is money spent on mapping, and it tends to come out of this area. And so I feel it's important that we just identify that this is a need, not only for the planning board, but for things that are done for the council or through the ordinance committee. And I also expect to see some town center mapping activities happening through the town center planning committee. Just an example of some of the things that came out of this year, the shoreline zoning map was prepared using this line item. In addition, the map that was prepared for the town center that was used for the November conference also was paid for through this line item. The next one, miscellaneous supplies, this is one of those that was reduced as part of the mid-year reductions, and I'm just listing the same amount again. Unless I hear some complaints from the planning board, we've decided to stop using blue paper. It's cheaper to use the white paper. So just, you know, this will be as little as we can get away with. Books is $100, again, a reduction, and something that I just expect to carry over from the previous year. There is no request for outlay, and I don't see any need for outlay. This year, we did have to buy a new computer. The computer I was using is from COG. The mouse was from the city of Portland, and the external drive was from the school department. And we put some money into repairs last year, repairs that should have lasted for several years, and instead it needed more repairs this year. So it didn't seem to make sense to put more money into a computer. And instead I have a new one, which has a lot more capacity and enables me to do most of the work I still do without any real support or staff support. Are there any questions?
Any concerns? Questions from the planning session?
Sounds good to me.
Maureen, it's this whole planning department has never functioned better. It's highly organized with all of the numerous continued requests to keep doing shoreland zoning and now start picking apart the wetlands and do the village concept and everything else that you're doing. It's a big job, and I think you've done it extremely well, and I'm very pleased.
Thank you.
Five sentiments,
Jim.
Thank you. Anybody else?
That's enough lunch for one time.
We'll spread the compliments out over the number of visits. Thank you for your budget preparation. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Council budget?
Pick the library.
Do you want to do the library?
Page 62.
Let's go through the library. We're on page 62 in the budget book, and it. Page 4 on the printout. Mr. Governor?
Yes, direct account part-time payroll, $450. That's for the $350 stipends the council members receive, the smallest stipends in the region.
Yes.
Printing and advertising, $1,700. That's for all the legal ads that are required to have by the state and by some of our own ordinances. Dues and memberships, $3,220. That is $720 for dues in the National League of Cities, plus approximately $2,500. That is the cost of the membership of one of your members serving as the vice chairman of the Human Services Steering Committee. Those are the expenses that are incurred with that position. Under conferences and meetings, total of $4,000. That's for all the miscellaneous local meetings you attend through Maine Municipal COG, some of the other workshops you attend, as well as $3,000 to enable the counselors, others to participate in the National League of Cities as well.
Okay, before we go any further, I'd like to get into, just to bring up for discussion, the consistency with department heads not traveling out of state for conferences and meetings, and by these budget recommendations, the counselors would be doing that.
The reason I recommend it for the counselors is I think most of the department heads have been here for a while. They have the opportunities over the years to do that while the council evolves a little bit more and is less exposed. Secondly, other than MMA, there rarely aren't any, which doesn't do a whole lot for elected officials, there aren't a whole lot of opportunities in state for development for the council, and that's why I saw a difference.
I also think that it's an opportunity for council members to not only find out what is happening around the country, but an opportunity for us to access, particularly through attendance at Washington conferences, our congressional delegation. And at times it has been, I think we've more than paid for by the cost of the conferences in the amounts of money that have come back to campus with as a result. So that I think it's, for a lot of reasons, we should try to continue to have counselors, particularly new people coming on board, to have an opportunity to have the kind of training that's offered. If we're going to pay dues to the National League of Cities, I think it would be a shame not to participate in some of the activities that really are training opportunities, as well as opportunities for lobbying activities in Washington. So in both of those regards, I think for a lay board, which we are, which is does not get compensated in any meaningful way for the work that we do, that we need to take advantage of some other opportunities for our own growth and our own capabilities of better serving the people we represent.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes, I'd like to speak myself. It's always a tricky thing when you're speaking and you have a vested interest, since I'm the steering committee member. I've worked on the steering committee of the Human Development Division now. This is my third year. 2 years I spent in the group of 35 that basically struggled with national health care policy. And then when I was asked to take on vice chairmanship of the committee this year, I knew that this was going to be at least debatable from the point of view of the council because of the tough times. My feeling is that there are, I guess, a variety of ways to look at serving on the National League of Cities. I think any involvement with the National League of Cities is a healthy thing for counselors. I think counselors can be accused of going on junkets when it's an out-of-state annual conference or when it's the yearly congressional conference in Washington. And I think you're just going to have a population of the citizenry that will feel any out-of-state conference is a junket, whatever you're doing. I think then there's the other issue of assuming a leadership position in NLC, which does require a fair amount of work behind the scenes, and does require, at least at the vice chairmanship level, a couple of extra meetings a year. This year, one will be in Detroit and one will be in Washington, D.C. It's certainly an honor for me to represent Cape Elizabeth at the National League of Cities leadership level. And I think it's an honor for Cape Elizabeth, in addition to myself. I think all sorts of weird opportunities arise when we find ourselves, although officially at a conference for perhaps a human development steering committee meeting, but having lunch with George Mitchell to put the tap on his shoulder for the $100,000 for the museum. So oftentimes you can sort of kill two birds with one stone. I feel very strongly about this issue, and I feel very strongly that really, if we have town employees who are in leadership positions, as is Debbie, as a staff development issue, we ought to support that.
Anybody else? Thank you. Bill?
No, I kind of concur with what Councilor Creamon had to say as far as people attending these things. I think you get a lot out of it, but I felt with you attending it under your capacity of the vice president that I thought this year we could do away without somebody else going. And this is my feeling that I'd be in favor of cutting that out.
I'd like to argue for leaving enough money in for one other person to possibly attend. Particularly just for exposure and training and hopefully somebody who hasn't gone before, whoever the new person is who takes my place. So I don't know if there are
people. You knocked me off that shit. Mm-hmm. Right.
So we have cut this back. It used to be a general policy that two people went to each of the two conferences, and that was one of our December cuts, I believe.
The Washington conference was cut December.
It was totally cut.
But by the way, just as a point of fact, the Washington conference for me would have cost approximately $1,000. When I accepted the vice chairmanship, I did it on the condition that Don Borat waived the registration fee for me, which was a savings of $300. And I kind of played Boy Scouts with bunking in Michael's room at the Hilton, which saved another $300 since he was being paid by Maine Municipal. So it actually cost about $200 for me to go down to that conference, just as a point of public record.
226, I think it was.
220. I stand corrected. $226 for anyone watching.
Continue.
You did fly, right?
So that means we either cut, we've got a total of $5,500 in there. How much are you suggesting we cut out?
Is it about $1,500 for one person to go?
Depends on which meeting it is. The Washington one is a little bit less than that.
So what is proposed right here in conferences and meetings is for one person to each of the two?
The 3,000 is?
The 3,000 represents one person to the December meeting, one person to the March Washington meeting.
In addition to Wayne, which is funded in the other group, and then Maine Municipal Association will be paying me to go to both, which is I'll be the president of MMA during this.
So maybe if we just had money for the person to go to the December meeting, because we'll have coverage at the Washington meeting. Both Michael and Wayne will be there.
So that could lead us to a $1,000 cut.
You might be able to go yet, you might be able to go yet.
Haven't been asked yet, though. Take it
easy.
The other thing is if, you know, we might be able to still have two go if MMA, you know, allows a double room, you know, that type of thing. Of course they would. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's other ways of...
You're assuming we're going to have male counselors.
Well, what I was thinking, we could say about Wayne's account.
You're assuming male counselors would be one.
Yeah, it wasn't that bad an experience. I can bunk in with Michael in New Orleans if...
You didn't even wake up when I came in at night.
I thought he'd be out later than you.
We better get this back to the financial discussion.
We are on the air.
yes. All right. The proposal for dues and memberships is $3,220. Do I hear any proposed revisions to that?
$1,500.
To dues and memberships?
I'll cut the $3,000 to $1,500.
That's a different account.
No, that's a different account, sir.
Oh, you've gone through.
I'm one before you, you're ahead of me, Bill.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, no changes.
I don't, I'm not hearing any changes on that. Okay, dues and memberships, no, conferences and meetings. Mr. Jordan, you're proposing to cut that by?
Cut it in half, $1,500.
Cut the $3,000?
Yeah.
I'm hearing support, I believe, for that.
See them crossing.
Does anybody dissent? For this $1,500. Okay, thank you. Sir, continue.
Oh, the audit, the professional services, a total of $59,000. This includes $11,000 for the annual audit, $1,000 for Memorial Day. We pay for all the flags in the cemetery, for a sound system, for some wreaths that are used at the ceremony. Legal fees, $45,500. And then there's also $1,500 miscellaneous. That's for everything from all the plaques that are ordered to flowers that are sent. Anything and everything that comes out. And council contingency, $5,000. That's a reduction of $3,020 from the current year. Goals implementation, $5,000. I did not recommend anything for the land acquisition fund because of the, I think going back to Janet's comments on, you know, what's a need, what's a necessity, even though I understand it is a priority. I didn't propose to fund it.
Could you just break down what goals, implementation, which ones we're implementing?
That's just this budget will be for the fiscal year beginning July 1.
Whatever
the council at that point will be going through a goals process.
Okay.
This will give, you know, some new priorities come forward at that point. It'll give the council an opportunity to devote some resources to those goals. That's it for the council account.
Any other questions on that? Okay. Thank you.
I want to continue to the hundreds.
I think that's fine.
You want to hurry, George?
You brought a book, didn't you?
Mr. Markin, let's go to elections. Mrs. Pizzo? This is on page 66 of the budget book and 5 of the computer program. We have with us Debbie Pizzo, who is the administrative assistant and overall overseer of elections.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. As you can see, this year's election budget is down. There are several reasons for that. The first reason is that we do have one less election this year. For FY93, we'd be looking at the November general election and for the May municipal election. I am pleased to inform you of several savings I have been able to find in this budget, although this budget isn't a great portion of the overall. I think every little bit helps. First of all, I was able to enter into a 3-year contract with our Optech voter tabulation machine, so I was able to get $200 per machine for 3 years, and I think that that's going to be a tremendous help because I think that the cost of those maintenance agreements would have gone up on us, so at least we're locked in for 3 years. Secondly, the company that we do our programming with for the machines, they will no longer be charging us an election support fee, so that is a savings of $150 a year. And finally, as Michael alluded to earlier, when I was at the New England Clerks Conference in Vermont in September, after talking to several clerks, there was a ballot printer from Fayetteville, North Carolina there. And this gentleman, of course, in the past has sent me material and information that I never have really paid attention to. So upon recommendations of several of the other clerks, I went over and talked to him, and the end result is that we will literally be saving 45% to 50% on ballot costs. And the company is reputable. He has been doing this for years and years and serves several of the other New England states as well as states outside of New England. So we will actually be realizing a savings this year in FY92 after the nomination papers close on Tuesday, Wednesday, I should be faxing out a ballot form to him, and then we'll be saving about 50% on those ballot costs.
Great.
So I was really, really pleased to find that savings. The, do you want me to go account by account?
You can go by account by account.
Again, part-time payroll, the stipend for the chairman of the Board of Voter Registration will be the same at 500. The stipend for the two members of the board are 75 each. Again, the rest of it cover ballot clerks, election wardens, all those stipends are the same. Overtime payroll, which is my overtime for elections, is down. Not only is down because of one less election, but the state changed the law that I do not have to be open Saturdays prior to state elections now, so that saves at least 4 hours overtime per state election. Printing and advertising.
Yeah. Excuse me, Debbie, you also got the election law changed. Debbie's the chairman of the Legislative Committee of the Clerks. She was instrumental in getting the law changed by how absentee ballots are processed. So rather than having to wait until the polls close and to spend an hour and a half working on those can now
be processed beginning at 2 p.m.
Great.
So hopefully we'll be able to send those right through before we close. Of course, in November, it might be kind of a little bit. We'll see what happens. Printing and advertising, again, is down because of the 45% to 50% savings in ballot costs. Miscellaneous supplies will keep the same for this year, and outlay will be down a little bit because of one less election that we'll have to program. There is a note on here that in June of 1993, the Portland Water District trustee election will be held, and the Water District does cover or reimburse us for those costs, so that is not included in this election.
We're likely going to have a Water District trustee election as well, June of this year.
That's my understanding.
The bill is now sitting on the governor's desk to change the charter of the district and the representation.
And that will also be covered by the Water District paying for it.
And one other thing, this year we almost had a special April election that would have, I guess, been covered by the state and costs and so forth, but seeing over the next year and a half, if there are any special elections, that would not be covered in this budget. We have to pick up those.
Yeah, speaking of that, I should have mentioned earlier when you're talking about the Public Works project, that bond that was apparently finally approved by the legislature yesterday does contain $10 million to be added in this year only to the local road assistance program. What it would mean is we would get half again as much of local road assistance revenue, or $31,000 that would have to be dedicated to capital improvements. You know, I'm not that optimistic it's going to pass in June, the jobs bond. There's a lot of feeling that it won't. But if it does, that would help to supplement would help to make up the $50,000 cut that we made this morning. But again, that's a real iffy proposition at this point.
Are there any questions on the elections account? Seeing none, thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Excellent job, Debbie.
Sitting through the day. Boards and commissions. Starting on page 68 and 6.
$7,100 is for the part-time secretary, Marsha, who works in the planning office, handling zoning and planning, as well as for Alice Allen, who does the minutes of the meeting. Marsha's the one that puts together all the packets and helps Maureen with projects, and as well as Ernie, and Alice does the minutes of the meetings. Printing and advertising is $2,500. That's for the appointments committee. Conservation Commission, Board of Zoning Appeals, Planning Board. There's $500 if different members of boards wish to attend different in-state conferences, that type of thing, meetings. Oftentimes, you know, a committee will decide that they will just some, like a cable TV or whatever coming up. You know, a 30 units, a $35 fee, it comes out of that account.
I hope those board and commission members are aware that that's available to them. Maybe that's something that we mentioned Tuesday night.
Professional services, that's $1,000. That's for the things. One thing I found out of this account, it still come out of the Main Street Nine, they have a senior citizen dance every year now, and they come for a donation of about $300. That comes out of this account. Some of those odds and ends that the board and commissions come in, can you find money for such and such? It comes out of this account. The Arts Commission and Conservation Commission had been included in that 2010 account. They now have their own accounts. Particularly the Arts Commission was always concerned that they could never easily get the balance in their account, and this would enable us to run a sheet off the computer to give them $1,500 to reach for for programming and for some of the different activities that they do. Jack Roberts has outlined here some of the things that he would like to do, and other issues that come up all the time amongst the different commissions.
I would recommend that next year the Arts Commission submit an outline similar to our conservation did this year.
That's it for boards and commissions.
Okay. Any questions on boards and commissions? You know, as we say repeatedly, we have such good volunteers in our boards and commissions. That's why I'm trying to encourage them to use the money set aside for them to attend training sessions and outside meetings. It's one of the small ways we can encourage them to maintain their interest. I think we all know how fortunate we are with the quality of the people we have volunteering for us. Okay. Insurance?
Workers' comp is now in the individual departments. The fidelity coverage bond was something I was complaining about a few years ago and how much it zoomed out of sight. Well, we were able to get the MMA risk pool to pick that up as part of that coverage, which has cut our cost in half. The public official liability policy is also, it's not part of the risk pool. It is purchased through MMA with about 340 other towns, and that's about budgeted $5,800 a year. That covers the council, all the people that work for the town, as well as the boards and commissions. The MMA insurance risk pool is budgeted at $30,000. That, when I first came to Cape Elizabeth in 78, I think we were paying about $55,000 for the same coverages, actually for less coverage than is now provided through the risk pool at $30,000. Self-insurance is, we have a $1,000 deductible for every incident, and this picks up the cost of the deductible, budgeted at $4,000.
Okay. Any questions on those items? Thank you. Employee benefits?
Social Security is now individually budgeted in the departments as well as retirement. We do have an administration fee, and it is included here. Health insurance is individually budgeted. Group life insurance, we pick up a premium for retired employees. We've always done it. That's about $1,000 a year. Unemployment comp is budgeted to increase somewhat because, you know, people who used to work for us, people who work part-time, volunteer firemen, they get laid off elsewhere. That hits our self-insured fund. And vacation sick leave accrual is the accrual that we have as a result of people getting additional sick leave, that when they leave, there's a payout that we have to pay, and that covers that. In the budget message, I noted that all of these benefits individually in the account were funded, assuming that a couple employees might get married, assuming that we were, you know, spend the full amount in the payroll accounts in each. What I propose that you do is, and I'm not sure where to put it in the budget, but maybe as a revenue, is an overall credit of $22,000, assuming that all of those things don't happen, that some of our single employees who I thought might get married don't get married. And also there's a couple in there on that, a couple people who aren't yet participating in the ICMA plan that I assume may in fact not. So what I'd like to do is propose a credit of $22,000, which is the equivalent of a budget deduction.
Discussion on that proposal? Phyllis.
I just have a question of Michael. How much vacation time do we let people accrue?
The policy is that you can accrue, with the permission of the manager, that amount which you're allowed to take the following year. One of the primary problems we have in liability is that the manager himself, myself.
We know about you.
Yeah.
you know, but as far as the employees.
Yeah, and the problem is, you know, if you let some, in my case, you know, this year there's no raise, but if there is a raise, your liability is increased for each one of those weeks by the amount of that raise for the year. So there's a real
issue.
It's
more expensive.
It gets more expensive.
Yes.
But, go ahead. So what the policy is it's the amount of vacation that you're allowed to have the next year.
Okay, so in business, if you don't take your vacation by the end of the year, you lose it.
Yeah.
So is that something that we need to consider as a policy issue for the town?
It would have to be treated as an amendment to the personnel code. The way we accumulate vacation, it's so much each week that it's, you accumulate, you know, one, so many hours per week, one point, you know, depending on what the different times are. I think, you know, the way people schedule their vacations, you know, you wouldn't be allowed then to have a vacation in January, February, or March, because you wouldn't have accumulated enough time. With, I think with the one exception of the myself, you know, it isn't really a problem.
Do we need to consider a policy change that if you have accrued vacation, that it is at the rate at which you were being paid at that time, so that we don't end up with this greater liability?
Again, I don't think it's an issue except for the manager's position. If you want to consider that for me, you know, that...
I didn't really have you in mind. I'm just thinking about business-wise, you know.
Yeah.
You lose it, you take it, or you lose it, and if you do get paid back, it's a salary.
I don't know of anyone that does that, but...
I would think that might be worthwhile if, we establish a committee or however we're going to look at
the benefits.
Package of benefits, that that be included in that look.
That and sick leave.
One problem we had, Phyllis, was that when people... The policy used to be when you came here, you weren't allowed to take a single day's vacation for a whole year. And we changed it instead to you began accumulating from the day you arrived, but yet you would earn it after. We changed it so you begin accumulating from the day you arrived, but you can't take any time for 120 days. So the problem is if you suddenly said now that you have to use it up, you know, we would have huge overtime problems, and the police department would have coverage problems everywhere.
Yeah, that's something we could consider. It's something we can package.
The real expensive provision is particularly the sick leave buyout provision.
Right.
Whereas if you're here for 10 years, you can get 1/3 of your accumulated sick leave. If you're here for 15 years, you can go with 1/2 of it. And that, you know, that liability for myself, again, you know, using me as the example, I have never been out sick in 12 years, but I have 120 days. That you take half of that, that's 60 days, that's 12 weeks pay. That's a lot of money.
I think we have to look at all those issues.
I think we have to look at them all. I think I feel very strongly that we need to look at them all together and not piecemeal.
Right.
I have great fear of doing that piecemeal. I do not support that at all.
I've often thought of, you know, the advantage of buying out those provisions. The problem with it is because we, you know, as long as the money that we have in the bank where those amounts are there are earning interest greater than the percentage increase of salary increase each year, we never get behind. So there's not, in that case, there's not an incentive to buy them out. If we can be earning 5% on our money and there's a 5% salary increase, it all comes out in the wash. The issue is, this year we're going to be fine on it because we're earning more in interest than the salary increases in the money.
Other concerns? Bill?
Yes, but you got, and I agree with what Elsa Cogshaw had to say, that it ought to be explored, but I don't know which. That'd be for future employees, because you've had some employees here 20 years or more, and they've accumulated quite a lot of sick leave.
Yeah, but you can only accumulate up to 100, that buyout only works up to 120 days,
right?
Yeah. But it is, you know, it's the type thing, you know, you could amend the personnel code to, and, you know, negotiate with the union on this next go around, that in future contracts, that's gone. You know, employees hired after X date, that's gone. And, you know, similar to what we're doing with the retirement system and ICMA, you wean yourself off it over time to, in the long run, you save a lot of money.
I think that's a project this council is going to undertake in the next year, and we'll have something to look at along those lines a year from now, next year. Other concerns with the insurance items, employee benefits, sorry. Okay, thank you. Into debt service.
The tax anticipation note, we ended up having to borrow some this year. It's projected next year that we would borrow again. Right now we have borrowed tax anticipation notes. Otherwise we would have run out of money this week by these calculations because of the way taxes are due. You know, if you change the tax due dates, to six-month intervals. Right now, we're 5 and 7, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But if you change that, that could reduce this cost. But anyway, it's $15,000 budgeted for tax anticipation note interest. Library debt principals, $30,000 for the project done several years ago. Interest, $33,255 for the library. The road recruitment bond of a few years ago, $3,000. A total of $75,470. There's a typo down below there in interest. It's more than that. Portable classroom bond, you can see the payment schedule on that. $27,864 this year. The community center, the payment this year, $31,500. This year, we're picking up principal of $20,000 each year. That was not in last year's budget. That runs until the year 2002. And the public works garage is $63,000, including $23,000 in interest and $40,000 in principal. This is the first year we pick up principal on that. So between the community center and the public works garage, this budget is picking up $60,000 in principal. End of debt service.
When is it appropriate to consider changing the tax payments from 5 and 7 to 6 and 6?
Well, it would be a long debate. Whenever you'd like to, you know, the issues are, you know, what months do you do it?
I think that's something that we might very well want to have looked into in the cost savings.
It's also, it's a problem for people that set aside so much each month that,
right,
you know, in one of the times they only have 5 months and another time they only have 7 months.
Yes, I do.
We also, that May gate is between, the May one is the big problem.
Because after taxes.
It's right, yeah, there's not enough time right after that one to get out the liens and all that. And it's also the election, the municipal elections coming up. It just seems to be one thing after another during that period. I'm forgetting something else this day.
So you do everything else?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Could be something we look into. Any other comments on the debt service? Okay, thank you. Let's go to the library account, please, number 510. And we have with us George Rollins, our head librarian.
Good to see you, George.
Good to see you.
I'm getting on to page.
I see all these smiles. You look in a generous mood, so I.
We just eat.
Thank you. How wrong you are.
How was the librarian report? It was a dark and dreary afternoon.
You came to look it up for us.
There's not much change from this budget from last year, and as you can see, the increase is overall 1.5%. And I'd like to add that for the last 3 years, the budget has not really changed that much. From 90 to 91, it was $210,000. 91, 92, $210,000, $634. And this year, $213,780. So as you can see, we've tried to hold the line. And I don't have to, I think, tell this council how important the library is to our community. But I think, I've been thinking about this for a while, and in order for a public good to remain good, I think we have to be careful not to allow the quality of services and the library's collection to fall below a certain level. So, you know, budgets, book prices go up and so forth. I think we have to maintain quality. You know, and the public good is an interesting concept because Mike and I talked about this yesterday morning for a couple of minutes. We had a short theoretical discussion, and we came to the profound conclusion that public goods mean public responsibility. But, you know, it's not a mere abstraction, and I think the coin a cliche that I think we sometimes don't see the forest for the trees. Maybe as a community, we should start asking certain questions. In difficult economic times such as these, what exactly is the public responsibility? What is the public good, the common good? What are the basic necessities important to a community in hard economic times? And I think sometimes we lose sight of some of these basic questions. What does it mean to be a citizen? What is one citizen's responsibility to another? So I think these are some of the questions I've been thinking about for quite a while. And I think it might be a good idea for a library program, have a discussion or a lecture series on some of these general questions, especially in these times. I better stop now, because if I go on, I'll be here all day, so I'll get to the specifics of my budget. But public good is an interesting concept. First, account 510-1001, full-time payroll, and as you can see, there's no change in this one. Same as last year. Next account, part-time payroll, 510-1002, no change from last year.
One thing I've been working with George, encouraging this computer project to come to a successful conclusion. He assures me that this will be it will be completed this coming year. He assures me.
George said yes.
One thing about the computer project, as you go along, you find a lot of mistakes. I mean, some of the cards in our old catalog were handwritten. And you have to change some of this. So I think as we're doing the project, we find this is the best time to change some of the mistakes we have in the old catalog, because the catalog is very important. So this entails printing new cards and changing subject headings. So I think as we go along, we're cleaning up some of this mess. So that's why it's taking a little longer than we thought.
That's great. We look forward to its conclusion in the next year.
Yes. Okay. Next account, 510-2001, telephone, no change. 510-2002, power, this is an increase, and this figure is based upon the use of 1991-92. I again talked with the Energy Services Advisor from CMP, and this is the figure he said that we're again, because of the computer use we have, it's hard to determine what the exact usage will be. And when we go online in the adult section, it may change again. Water and sewer, slight increase. Postage, no change. Conferences and meetings, no change. 510-2002. Programs, no change. Building repair and maintenance, the two major things here are the cupola. We're going to replace the cupola. Now, we won't replace it, but we're going to modify the louvers. But we believe that some of the rain and snow may be coming in to those louvers. And also, we're going to replace some shingling on the roof. Roof repairs. Next, contingency fund, no change. 510-2072, miscellaneous contract services, no change. 510-3001, office supplies, no change. And I might add, this has been the same for 3 years now, $2,000. So again, as you know, the cost of these products do increase, but it's the same.
George, on the heat, that may change. We're not going to know that. We're looking at the heating item for all town accounts.
Okay.
So that may change just on the administrative recommendation.
Next, miscellaneous supplies. Again, there are no change. Books and periodicals, there's a slight increase, 4.4%. And some of that will go to support the Herb Chapel collection. I mean, this man is fast.
Hey,
I mean,
George, this is live. Now cut it out.
This man, when he leaves a library, he has 10 books. I mean, at a time. So if you're going to allow town council to read more books than I can buy, you're going to have to increase this budget. I've even thought of erasing your number in the back of the book card so you wouldn't should read the same book again. But again, with the book budget, Now, in, again, the increase in prices on books, in 1990 to 91, it increased 5.1%. 91, 92, 5.7%. So the cost of books increases all the time. The average hardcover book is $22, which is absurd. So again, I'm asking for a slight increase, but I think at one point we'll really have to look at the collection or the quality of the collection, because you must maintain it at a certain level. Next, audiovisual material, a slight increase. An outlay, an increase for computer material and service contracts.
Okay, are there any other concerns in the library accounts?
No, I'm in favor of it.
You're in favor?
Yes.
That's always encouraging. I think
there's some you'd like to add.
Submit your book list, right?
I have one, Jordan. I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Is this the same deal as far as the public works and the power? Because the library hasn't increased that much. And I just can't understand why the public safety building would increase so much. I think that ought to be explored.
Well, we got a notice from Central Maine Power for that particular building, and it was the only one we got back, saying that it was now, the rate was under review. So it is in fact being reviewed.
At a higher level than us.
But yeah, while it's being reviewed, we're paying a higher rate.
Yeah. Well, but the PUC has approved the current rate, so.
We're paying the rate that's been approved.
Yeah. We can't not pay our electric bill.
Oh, I understand all that, but I'm just saying, it seems that they pick out one building. Yeah, I haven't seen any other building that the power has changed but a little bit, but they pick out one building within the town, yeah. You might say the most important building that needs power, and jump the rate about double. I just can't understand it.
It was because of the characteristics of the way that building used power was the reason it was picked up. You know, they have the demand meter picked up that it was using power at certain times. And,
it's on 24 hours a day.
It's on 24 hours a day.
That's the one building we have now in operation. Okay. Is there any other comments, Phyllis?
I just wanted to ask George, in your purchasing of books, is there some agency you go through so you get a discount? So the $22 hardcover is really a $25 hardcover?
Yes, we don't actually pay that. We get a 44% discount. On our, the primary agency, the primary vendor is Baker & Taylor. And we do most of our book buying from Baker & Taylor. But again, book prices do increase every year. And if you're going to try to maintain a collection, especially reference books are very expensive. And to maintain that kind of informational service, we have to look carefully at this from year to year. But we do buy through one major vendor.
Thank you. Anything else?
George, are there many people who donate books to the library in memory of people who pass on?
Yeah. Many, no, I think our last year we took in library fund right now is $2,700. But from time to time, yes, people do donate books to the library in memory.
And we I'm wondering if it's something that we could encourage more of, if people were aware. In lieu of sending flowers, or
whatever,
donating,
go to.
Well, recently, last spring, I think, we
published a wish list in the Cape Courier. And at that time, sorry to say, there wasn't much response to it. Again, we're in tough times here, economic times, but people do donate.
Since July 1st, the total amount of donations has been $3,703. It's a fairly substantial amount.
That's good. People should also know that they can donate the books on tape. That collection is growing too, and a lot of times, you know, you put the tape in the cassette in a trip back and forth, and you've heard it, and it's done. You just throw it in the corner of the room.
As you can see in the budget, there is no money for that next year. So,
but that's a very popular
item. Tape donations.
Yeah. Let me step back, and I just said part of that amount I just mentioned, I think, was from the book sale as well.
Book sale, yes.
So about half of that is for the book sale, and half for the...
Over $1,000 was from the book sale.
I'm wondering if maybe it was an article in conjunction with an article on the budget as a whole, that we submit an article on the possibility of different ways of donating to the library, to the Curia.
Might be different ways of donating to the town in general.
Yeah, to the library.
Someone might have $22,000 to give to the police department for a tape system.
Sure.
Eh?
Yeah.
You don't know?
Okay, anything else on the library budget? I think you take the lack of questions as our, as a positive step in our policy agreement with where you're coming from and how you operate the library, the services it provides.
Thank you very much.
Do a good job. Thank you for your preparation, for being here this afternoon. Sure, 520 while we're here. Turn to the next, it's page 180, it's contributions.
On page 180, it includes $450 donation of the Cape Preservation Society to maintain the Records Preservation Center at the Thomas Memorial Library. This was the amount we had been donating to them every year until a budget reduction last year. Family Fun Day, $9,000, that's for the full range of activities, is about $4,000 less than they had been spent, excuse me, a few years ago. Cable TV program, Lillian will be coming up in a few minutes, and that's now a separate account. The main development.
We had a memo or something here a while ago as far as Family Fun Day, as far as them using the revenue, I just can't remember. They're using the revenue that they took in and added to what was budgeted. Is that the way this budget is put together?
No, that was at the council meeting I missed, we had the discussion about the parking fees. The policy had been that you allowed them to keep the parking fees. I had not budgeted any income for the parking fees. You know, and that would, you know, under the old policy, when this budget was put together, that would have supplemented the appropriation of the $9,000. So, you know, whether or not you want to put in a revenue in the revenue side of, you know, guesstimating what the parking revenue might be and adding it to here, I hadn't really given it a thought since Debbie had told me.
Well, that's the way I'd like to do it. I don't know about the rest of them, because I think $9,000 is enough for Family Fun Day.
If we want to earmark...
Other, then we should vote on it.
And the $9,000 would be for Family Fun Day a year from June?
Yeah.
Just so everybody stays aware of that. Any other comments on earmarking those revenues from the parking to go to Family Fun Day?
The income from this Family Fun Day would reduce the $9,000 for the next one.
Would it reduce it, or would it be in addition?
No, any revenue, the way, what I'm hearing, would be a general fund, would R0326 miscellaneous revenue go into that account? Could not be accessed. I've been having an ongoing similar discussion with the Arts Commission. You know, they sponsor different programs, and, you know, what about the admission revenues? Their feeling is, you know, that it ought to be an incentive for them to get more people there to, you know, if they're able to keep those funds to help defer the cost of the programs. We go back and forth.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
You know, it's the whole issue of, you know, do you want these groups to be entrepreneurial or not? If, you know, if you let them keep their own revenues, they can be, they tend to be more entrepreneurial.
Then we reduce the subsidy from the town.
Yeah.
Right, they also tend not to be as accountable.
Exactly, that's the other side of it. Okay.
I spoke my piece.
Yeah, so keep that at $9,000. Main Development Foundation, this is a group that does the meeting of the legislature on business issues. A lot of cities and towns belong, it's $200 dues. I can't say they do that much directly for us, other than, you know, something we'll belong to for a number of years, help contribute to it. Convention and Visitors Bureau, $500, this is, we support of the region's Convention and Visitors Bureau.
How does that support us directly, benefit us directly?
I think, you know, they provide overall promotion for the greater Portland region. obviously, we now have a revenue thing, revenue thing. We now have the museum.
A revenue item.
We now have the museum, the gift shop, and Portland Headlight. And, you know, while people are going to be coming anyway to Greater Portland, and if they come, they're going to go there, you know, not that we want to be encouraging outsiders necessarily, you know, they've been very helpful to Cape Elizabeth in promoting the lighthouse, and I'm sure they will the museum. Yeah, it's debatable.
I agree with him on that, because I think if any convention in the city of Portland, that it's brought up to them that you want to ride out to the lighthouse, what have you. And if you don't want them up there, then we should strike it out. You don't advertise it and then not want them. A lot of people like to ride out there. And from the Midwest, I know my grandson came home from college with a couple of kids here last spring, I guess it was, before the spring break, and one of them never seen the ocean. Pretty hard for me to believe. I've never seen the Midwest.
There are two other advantages which I should mention. One is we get a lot of cards here. People send me information on Cape Elizabeth. We send them all into the Convention and Visitors Bureau, and they respond to all those things for us, unless there's a particular issue, like there was one that Cheryl, I gave to this, that wanted to know exactly what every wording was on the plaque down in Portland Headlight. Someone had been there and didn't write it all down and wanted to know. They also do give us copies of their brochure that we have here at the counter that a lot of people pick up, along with the lighthouse on the cover. It lists all the places to eat and do other things in the region.
And, benefit is that it's good for the economy in this area to encourage people to come here. It helps with finding summer jobs for our students. And we have several people who live in town who rely on this industry, so. I think there are a lot of benefits for a very small amount of investment.
One of our top 10 taxpayers as well, being by the sea, you know, help get assistance from this.
Thank you for the discussion. Nice to have it discussed.
You know, the Portland Museum of Art, I think a lot of the same issues would carry forward, same discussion. Although it was particularly unique here is that there are a lot of school tours from Cape Elizabeth that go. I think they've presented us information in the past that shows that we probably utilize it as a per capita student basis more than any other school system in the state.
Any other questions on the contribution account? Thank you. Okay, human services.
Want to do cable TV, 5:30?
Sure. We're all right here, that's right. Don't have to turn into pigs.
I don't know if everyone's heard, but Lillian Bates is resigning as our cable TV coordinator.
Oh.
Someone that, you know, I think Lillian's still here? Someone that...
it's time to come out.
You know, she'll certainly be missed, and yeah, we had a real good discussion the other day on what some of the needs are in the cable TV program area, and I think she's just done an outstanding job. Come right ahead.
Why not?
Sit down in the hot seat.
So she's willing to, you know, continue to do it until we are able to find someone new in the process where we begin.
And also only leaving as coordinator, not leaving as a volunteer.
So we have with us Lillian Bates, who's our coordinator for our cable television operation. The floor is yours, Lillian.
And I'm not prepared because I didn't know I was going to be here, but our budget is our payroll, which covers the town meetings, the equipment, maintenance, everything's getting a year older, so we really need that money. Miscellaneous supplies are tapes and things such as I had to replace our Atari computer. And the outlay is for a new sound system. Also, it's an addition mistake on my part. I think it's $7,780. You already have those figures.
Janet figured out it's a little less than was added up.
Okay. This sound system, when it put in, was originally put in only to support the two speakers. And it was just in this room. So since you've added the cable, it's being stressed, and I think eventually
if not this year, next year, you would want to replace it.
The other problem we have is I wander around a lot more during meetings than most of you do, but you know, sometimes I'm sitting out here in the audience. You have a really difficult time hearing in the audience what's going on out here.
And that's because when you crank the sound up, you're cranking all the mics plus the speakers plus the podium. You really need a mixer where you can turn up either the in-house sound or, you know, one individual person versus everybody on the board.
Yeah, as you can see, this would, everyone would have a low profile mic that sits up there, all nine folks, one of those lavalier mics similar to the little ones you can see here on the table.
Well, they're flat, yeah.
Flat?
Yeah.
They're not pin-ons?
No. Okay. They're not. We decided against pin-ons because people walk away while they're still pinned on.
And you don't always wear clothes that accommodate the pin-ons.
That's true, too, yeah.
The
mics wouldn't be so far. These mics are real far up, and they're meant to be spoken into the mics you have up there. Now, these would be low profile, and you wouldn't have to, you know, lean into them to speak each time.
It's one of those issues. It's, you know, the sound really is bad in this room, particularly for people that don't hear too well. I know, you know, some folks you see always sit in the front here. It's so bad, but even then, it's a big ticket item. It's $7,780. About $500 less than the budget indicates, but
$780.
We need it. The issue is, do you want to do it this year?
And it also affects the sound and the TV at home.
Yeah. Yes, it does, because you can't crank it up because you're cranking everything up. And these mics, if they're turned up too high, then all you get is feedback. You know that.
I think we heard that this morning.
Mm-hmm. But you can't continue to use these mics and put your mixer in?
It would have to be a new system.
And so somebody mentioned it a few years ago when it was installed that you ought to get modern mics and what have you, and not take these antique ones.
Council's been complaining about the sound system here since
day one.
Since day one. Yeah. And this year, I asked Lillian to put together an estimate, which she did.
Is this almost state-of-the-art, or is it state-of-the-art?
State-of-the-art,
you'd be three times
spending for a $50,000 sound system.
But this is a good system. Yeah. I mean, it's not, you know, bargain basement.
Now, state-of-the-art, you know, you'd probably want to put in a lower ceiling. You'd want to have, you know, speakers,
lights,
you know, throughout.
Hanging from the ceiling,
yeah.
Yes.
And, you know, we're not.